You can't truly talk about World War II aircraft without mentioning one of the most important aircraft in history, the Spitfire. This masterpiece is famous among most aviation enthusiasts, and rightfully so, with it being arguably the most successful fighter of the war. While this fighter has gone down in history as one of the most impactful airplane designs, one more thing, or rather person, that I feel not as many people know of or appreciate enough is a man who designed the Spitfire and other supermarine ideas, known as Reginald Mitchell. In Staffordshire, England, at 115 Congleton Road, Butt Lane, Reginald Joseph Mitchell was born on May 20, 1895. He was the oldest of three brothers and the second oldest of five children. His father, Herbert Mitchell, contributed to the founding of Wood, Mitchell & C. Ltd., a printing company. From the age of 8, Reginald attended Queensbury Road Higher Elementary School before transferring to Hanley High School. There, he discovered a passion for building and flying model airplanes. In 1911, he began working as an apprentice with Kerr Stewart & Co. of Fenton, a railway engineering firm, after completing his education at the age of 16. After completing his apprenticeship, he worked at Kerr Stewart in the drawing department while attending a nearby technical college to study engineering and mathematics, where he showed aptitude in the field. Following his departure from Kerr Stewart in 1916, Mitchell briefly worked as a part-time teacher. He submitted two applications to the military, but was denied both times due to his engineering background. In late 1916, Mitchell joined the Supermarine Aviation Works at Southhampton, possibly for a probationary period. Since its founding in 1912, the company primarily specialized in the construction of flying boats. The Pemberton Billing PB-1, the business's first airplane, was produced in 1914. After being taken over by the British government during World War I, Supermarine created the Supermarine Baby, the nation's first single-seat flying boat fighter. Mitchell was given the chance to grow in a variety of roles after entering the company in order to gain knowledge of the aircraft business. As he transitioned from dealing with trains to handling airplanes, his foundational engineering background would have aided him in establishing himself. Mitchell, a skilled mathematician, quickly gained recognition for his capacity for original thought and intuitive design methodology. His employment at Supermarine is first mentioned in a 1916 draftsman document. By 1917, he had become assistant to the company's owner and designer, Hubert Scott Payne. It would not be long until Mitchell received a promotion in 1918 to assistant manager, and soon after, he took over as head designer for Supermarine after William Hargraves left the firm in the summer of 1919. After receiving his promotion, the 19-year-old went back to Staffordshire and wed Florence Dayson, the headmistress of an infant school who was 11 years older than him. He was Supermarine's head engineer by 1921. Mitchell was able to negotiate a new contract after Scott Payne left the company in November 1923, which gave him more influence inside the organization. Little records from Mitchell's early career have survived, so it is unknown how he managed to advance so swiftly when he was still a young man. At the time, not many men Mitchell's age held comparable positions for other aircraft companies. Thus, his early rise was unusual. 24 airplanes were created by Mitchell between 1920 and 1936. In many of his early efforts, Mitchell modified Supermarine's earlier aircraft. For example, when the Air Ministry issued a competition for commercial aircraft in June 1920, Supermarine submitted the Commercial Amphibian, a modification of the company's Supermarine Channel by Mitchell. Despite coming in second place, the Amphibian was thought to have the best design and dependability of the three competitors. The Supermarine Sea King, which he had rebuilt from the Supermarine Baby, was displayed at the Olympia International Aero Exposition in 1920. The first such event to take place in the UK since the end of World War I. At the Air Ministry's Light Air Competition in 1924, Supermarine's first attempt at a land-based aircraft, the Supermarine Sparrow, competed poorly and never received any orders. In March 1924, construction on the Supermarine Southampton began. The following March, it took to the air for the first time, and in July 1925, it went into service. The Southampton II, which was the Southampton but had a metal hull, was created by Mitchell's team before the end of 1925. In 1927, the aircraft made its first flight, outperforming its predecessor in terms of strength, weight, and durability. The Southampton established Britain as a top producer of maritime aircraft and was one of the most successful flying boats of the interwar era. Up until 1936, it was utilized to outfit six RAF units. In 1926, to meet the demands for a new fighter aircraft, the Air Ministry released Specification 21/26. Mitchell's design team, which he had divided into distinct drawing and technical offices that year, responded with a number of concepts, including the single-seat fighter. Supermarine had by this point abandoned wooden amphibious planes. Instead, the business focused on creating bigger metal flying boats. Supermarine produced a number of designs for a six-engine flying boat in response to the 1928 specification R.6/28, one of which represented a significant departure for Mitchell, since it included a newly developed 140-foot cantilever wing with a sizable surface area and cross-section. The plane was never constructed, but he proceeded to develop aircraft based on the Southhampton and the Southhampton II from 1929 to 1931, including the Type 179, the Nanook, the Seamew, the Supermarine Seahawk, and its derivative, the Seahawk II. Mitchell created the Sea Lion II from the Supermarine Sea King II, which was used in Naples to compete for the Schneider Trophy in 1922. Flying at an average speed of 145.7 miles per hour, the Sea Lion II won the race. Supermarine did not have enough time to create a new flying boat for the 1923 competition, therefore, Mitchell was given permission to modify the Sea Lion II after borrowing it from the Air Ministry. With the help of D. Napier & Son, who provided the 525-horsepower Lion III engine, he boosted its top speed by 12 miles per hour. Mitchell adjusted the struts, floats, and hull, as well as how the engines were mounted to reduce the impacts of drag forces. The wingspan was also decreased from 32 to 28 feet. Two of the three British competitors for the race in 1923 were already irreversibly damaged, leaving the Sea Lion III to compete alone. The winning pilot, David Rittenhouse, was part of the U.S. team that won the competition, flying Curtiss seaplanes. Rittenhouse was able to reach a high speed of 177.27 miles per hour. Mitchell continued to work on a new aircraft even while the Sea Lion II was being altered at the Woolston factory, because Supermarine was aware that the American monoplane was the best model at the time. The Supermarine S4 was a cooperative project between Napier and Supermarine. Mitchell came up with the moniker with S standing for Schneider. The Supermarine team enjoyed more leeway than the U.S. government's designers because of the support of the Air Ministry. After Mitchell's passing, the S4 was referred to as his first remarkable success. As he created its successor, the Supermarine S5, he drew on his practical expertise. Mitchell was well aware that increasing speed required lowering drag. He came up with a cantilever mid-wing floatplane for his novel design. It was akin to the Bernard SIMB V2, a French monoplane that set a new flight airspeed record in December 1924. The S4 was aerodynamic and attractive, even if it lacked the newly developed surface radiators, which were at the time yet unavailable. Trial speeds of 226.7 miles per hour made headlines and generated excitement in the media. Before the 1925 race, the S4 crashed for unidentified reasons. It halted on the day of the navigation trials, and then fell flat into the water from a height of 100 feet. Although Mitchell was able to ensure that Supermarine would be prepared for the race, the Air Ministry, the Society of British Aircraft Constructors, and the Royal Aeronautical Society opted against competing for the Schneider Trophy in 1926. In November of that year, he began working for the NPL. He discovered that the S4's radiators were responsible for a third of the overall drag on the aircraft, and that without them, the aircraft would have been the most aerodynamically efficient craft in the entire world. No aircraft could be finished and tested in time to be submitted. Despite British aviation manufacturers' best efforts to produce entrants for the 1926 race, due to the Air Ministry's standards. For the 1927 competition, which took place in Venice, two Supermarine S5 seaplanes were entered. Mitchell was persuaded by wind tunnel studies at the NPL that the cantilever wing design was too heavy and should be abandoned. Mitchell knew that a monoplane on twin floats produced lower drag than any other aircraft type in its day. Mitchell utilized them to enhance the S5, since the NPL had shown that flat-surfaced, skin radiators reduced drag better than the corrugated version used by American designers. He decreased the fuselage cross-section area such that it was 35% less than the area of the S4, and then whined that the resulting S5's cockpit was too small for the RAF pilots. The thickness of the fuselage skin was reduced by using duralumin. In front of Mussolini, and a sizable crowd gathering along Venice's Lido, the two Supermarine S5 aircraft finished the race on their own, finishing first and second. The three Italian competitors flying Machi M52s and the third British participant, a Gloster 4, had to withdraw from the race. In 1918, Mitchell was chosen to join the RAES. He received the Society's Silver Medal in 1927. He was appointed Technical Director of Supermarine at the year's end. He continued to serve as Supermarine's principal designer when Vickers Ltd. acquired the business in 1928. One of the terms of the acquisition was that he continued to work as a designer for the following 5 years. A fighter aircraft that could be utilized by day and night squadrons was called for in specification F7/30, which was published in 1930. The Type 224, Mitchell's suggested design, was one of three monoplane concepts developed into prototypes for the Air Ministry. The final design included a fixed undercarriage, four Vickers machine guns, an open cockpit, and a 660-horsepower Rolls-Royce Goshawk engine. The engine's cooling system required an inverted gull wing. Thus, that was also included. Flaps were necessary for the wing in order for the aircraft to land at a safe speed. Unofficially named the Spitfire, the Type 224 first flew in February 1934. The cooling system malfunctioned to keep the engine from overheating, which contributed to the aircraft's ungainly appearance and inefficiency. The RAF chose the Gloster Gladiator over the Type 224 because they were dissatisfied with its performance. As the Type 224 was still being constructed in 1933, Mitchell began working on the Type 300's design. The Supermarine Spitfire was to become his crowning achievement. With the same engine but a shorter wing and a retractable undercarriage, he improved the Type 224's design. The Air Ministry rejected Mitchell's design, but he changed it, adding a newly designed Rolls-Royce Merlin engine, a thinner and shorter wing, and a novel cooling system, the latter of which shows his openness to incorporating suggestions from others. Initially, design work was funded privately, but in December 1934, the Air Ministry hired Supermarine to build a prototype based on Mitchell's design. Mitchell disagreed with the Air Ministry's desire that a tail wheel be added to the Spitfire. He was not informed at the time that the government had opted to construct hard surface runways for the RAF in anticipation of a future conflict, a choice that necessitated the modification to the Spitfire. The prototype, designated K5054, made its first flight on March 6, 1936, over Eastleigh, Hampshire. Mitchell saw the takeoff and landing. He went to Eastleigh for the K5054 flying tests, despite being sick. Before the prototype had finished being tested, the Air Ministry ordered 310 Spitfires in June 1936. The thin, elliptical wings of the Spitfire were created by Canadian aerodynamicist Beverly Shenstone, and the aircraft resembled the Heinkel HE-70 Blitz in terms of several technical advancements achieved by individuals other than Mitchell. The Royal Aircraft Establishment had created the underwing radiators, while the United States had invented monocoque construction. As a result of his, quote, unparalleled expertise in high-speed flight, and a brilliant practical engineering ability, exemplified in this instance by the incorporation of crucial lessons learned from Supermarine's unsuccessful Type 224 fighter, Mitchell's achievement lay in the fusion of these various influences into a single design. Throughout World War II, the Spitfire's superior design would acquire constant advancements, which would allow the aircraft to exhibit a great success rate, and ultimately allow us to view it as an all-time great, even to this day. In order to treat his rectal cancer, Mitchell underwent a permanent colostomy in 1933, rendering him permanently scarred. Despite this, he kept working on the Spitfire in the Type 317, a four-engine bomber. He took flying training, which was unusual for an aircraft designer in those days, and in July 1934 he received his pilot's license and completed his first solo flight. Mitchell received a second cancer diagnosis in 1936. And his illness compelled him to stop working in the early months of the following year. His aide, Harold Payne, oversaw the design group at Supermarine while he was away. Mitchell took a plane to Vienna to receive specialized care, where he spent a month before flying back to his own country when the care proved futile. He died at home in Portswood, Southampton on the 11th of June, 1937, at the age of 42. The quality of the flying boats designed by Mitchell for the RAF established him as the foremost aircraft designer in Britain. His obituary, published in the Journal of the Royal Aeronautical Society in 1937, described him as brilliant and one of the leading designers in the world. The Society paid tribute to their colleague, describing him as being a, quote, quiet, subtle, not obvious genius, who had an intuitive capacity for grasping the essentials, getting to the point, and staying there. I hope you enjoyed this different kind of video. I would like to hear your thoughts on Supermarine and the craft they developed, especially Reginald Mitchell's. If you are interested in a video on any of the planes mentioned, please let me know in the comments, as I would be happy to create a video on any of these historic aircraft. As usual, if you did enjoy the video, then maybe consider subscribing and dropping a like. I would really appreciate it if you'd also think about clicking one of the other videos from my channel above. Thank you for watching, and I hope to see you around in my other videos.